So first of all, thank you again, all the organizers, for inviting me. It's been really an honor for me to be here and present our results onto the Human-Robot Collaboration Axis. So I lead a lab of about 30 people. We've been growing a lot lately, and our main financing resources come from two sources, so one from joint labs with the industries, and the other one from European projects. So we have basically four joint labs with Daniele Camozzi and the Honda Research Institute of Japan, and also another classified lab, a big classified I cannot talk about. And then there is also two European projects. So what do we do in the lab? So we have basically three main research axes. The first one is agent-robot collaboration. It's been a long time we work on this. So I was a postdoc under the supervision of Francesco Nori, working in Codico. So it's been since 2014. Then on the telex system side, we are working also in advanced teleoperation methods for humanoid robots that we call teleexistence. And then we have also the aerial humanoid robotics. So you see there are some experiments. Here I have the jetpack close to me. I don't know if you see. So we were supposed to do the first experiments in April, but then the COVID outbreak blocked us. Anyways, today I'm going to talk about agent-robot collaboration and shared control. And what is the overall objective? So the overall objective is to give humanoid robots a new level of awareness about human intentions and ergonomy. And the shared control infrastructure is intimately related to the Andy project that we are working on. Andy was written by Francesco Nori, and as soon as it got accepted, Francesco left for Google DeepMind. So we carried on the scientific activities. So what do we have? Do we have on one hand the human, and on the other hand we have the robot? So, and then these two systems exchange interactions. And the overall approach is to basically synthesize controllers with the human models and learning, which provides feedback, which provides control inputs to the robot. And the main key developed technologies are basically two. On one hand, we have a suit to perceive human motions and forces. On the other hand, we have control algorithms. So let's start from the human. What do we do concerning the human side? So the overall approach is this one. We have a human. We give it with sensors, and then we get data from sensors. We apply our fusion algorithms. So this is really important. We use with the years of algorithms to retrieve the state of the human. So here we should talk about what the state is. So for the time being, although I'll show you some new things concerning the hardware. So for the time being. And mostly over the years, so I've been using XSense, but we use XSense as a set of sensors. So this is really important. We don't use basically the processing. And if you use only the IMU, what you can extract theoretically is position, velocity, accelerations of the human basically joints. So let's see how we do this. So this is inherently related to the classical inverse kinematics problem. What is the inverse kinematics problem? So given rotation matrices and angular velocities of each human link, so you have R and omega, how can I retrieve the human joint angle S? So why do we call it S, the human joint angles? Because for floating based systems, there is a little bit of problems in terms of rotation. We use S to remind the shape. So if you change the joint angles, you have basically different shapes. The system looks different. So historically, the inverse kinematics basically can be solved in two ways. So the first one is, so this is a little bit of recall of inverse kinematics. On one hand, you can use optimization-based approaches. So you basically want to find the configuration Q, if you have fixed-based robots, that minimize the distance between, in this case, Euclidean distance between XD, which is the position of the end effector, and the forward kinematics. On the other hand, you can use the so-called integration-based approach. So integration-based approach, on the right-hand side, you have that they exploit Jacobians. And then they exploit also time integration of the overall system. And usually we replace X dot desired with X dot star in order to somehow enforce the output of the inverse kinematics. So this is a recall. So what do we do the nice things of this is that it's really fast than the optimization based. and scales pretty quickly and nicely with the degrees of freedom. Clearly, there are also the cons, but I'm not going to touch the cons for the time being. So what do we do in terms of the human? Okay, so what we want to do is to exploit the rotation matrices, basically estimated from the IMUs and the angular velocity, the angle, and also the angular velocities in order to retrieve the human joint angle. So you can basically exploit the Jacobians, and the Jacobians is structured in two basically parts. One is the mu HB, velocity of the base. And then you have S dot, which is the joint angle of the human, okay? So here it's important to use another symbol like nu or V for the base velocity because the system belongs to the Lie groups. So in the case we use QB dot, then we risk a lightning from the sky because God could punish us since basically you are integrating artificial singularities to the system. So that's why you never see in this presentation, Q dot nor Q dot dot. So the first step would be to retrieve joint velocities, and then you basically can integrate joint velocities in order to retrieve the joint angles. What is the problem if you do so? The problem if you do so is that you don't exploit the rotation matrices, which comes from the IMU measurement, and you may also have divergence. So you have to add that component we saw before, that was x minus x dot desired in terms of control. But unfortunately here, if you want to add somehow an error, a rotation matrix error, you cannot basically do the difference of rotation matrices, but you have to basically exploit the Lie group structure of rotation matrices. So you can correct the inverse kinematics through expressions coming from the stabilization of rotation matrices on Lie groups. So, and then once you do so, you can not only retrieve only the human joints angle, also the entire state. And in this case, you have to somehow integrate the underlying system in a delicate way, because if you integrate SO3, then you have to add the so-called Bongard stabilization. So overall, story short, I hope you see the video nicely. Here there is Lorenzo running, and we have the IMU, we take IMU information. This is a 66 degrees of freedom model. It was running about at 10 kilometers per hour, and we were running the inverse kinematics online with less than 1 second. So the entire software infrastructure also takes into account several humans. So it works also nicely, scales up with several humans and several xns. So this concerns the kinematics estimation. Now, let's move towards the dynamics estimation. Clearly, if you use only kinematics data, you cannot estimate both nicely joint torques and external forces. So you miss a sensor. And that's why we built sensorized shoes. So we built these shoes, which have two force torque sensors, and two IMUs, and inside there are also two temperature sensors. On the top of that, we also made them wireless. So we had to build a network, I'll talk about it later, of wireless sensors. So that's basically our shoes. And if you complement basically the kinematics data coming from XSense, you may also hope to then estimate online human joint torques and external forces. However, the two FT sensors cost about 6K, so these are pretty expensive and ugly shoes. So the idea was, why don't we make an insole? Derived from the ICAB scheme, capacity-based sensors in order to make an insole which goes inside. That's been a long journey of technological process, because we really didn't think that the ICAP skin could work. But then by playing with the dielectric, we could make it work. And the results were unexpected, I have to say. So this is the pressure distribution coming from the insole. And on the right-hand side, you see the pressure distribution. So you can see the distance between the thumb and the foot. This was really unexpected, I have to say. And we have I mean, we have papers also detailing the calibration procedures. We had to build a vacuum chamber in order to create uniform pressure distributions in order to calibrate these sensors, because it's really time consuming to calibrate these sensors. And we were really satisfied about the outcome. And now we are making also the stretchable version of the insole. So right now you have you basically have this further information of external force, and you may also estimate human joint torque and external forces. How do we do so? So if you take the human dynamics treated as a set of rigid bodies, you have in the top left the floating base system. As you see, there is no Q dot dot because we risk the lightnings from the sky. So there is only the nu dot. So if you write this in terms of RNA, so recursive Newton Euler algorithms, you can basically rewrite the overall systems in another way. You can stack what? You can stack the internal accelerations, internal forces inside the vector D. Inside the vector D, you can stack it in the way that there are link accelerations, internal forces, external forces, and also joint accelerations. So if you define this vector D, you can rewrite the floating base systems in another way, and it is composed of basically two parts. One part is given by the measurements. So what you measure can be expressed linearly with respect to this D, and it's the so-called vector Y there. And the other one are constraints due to the dynamical model of the system, which is the RNA itself. So since this is basically linear, you can apply a maximum a posteriori estimation. So if you apply maximum a posteriori estimation, you can translate this problem in an optimization problem, and you can estimate with one shot internal and external forces and also accelerations. So what are the outcomes? So these are the outcomes. You have Claudia walking, and you have these red and white balls inside around the joints. So the higher the redder, the higher the estimation of the fatigue. This approach, however, has a certain number of problems. So the first problem is that it's really difficult to tune the covariances in the maximum posterior estimation framework. And the second one is that we had no external force estimate, and the external force estimation was really poor. So if Claudia picked up a box, then the overall estimation of the external forces was really poor. But why this? Because basically not having an external force sensor, let's say this, all the residuals were put in the unknowns. So what didn't match between the model, the measurements were put into the unknowns, and the resulting external force estimation were really poor. So in order to address this problem, what did we do? We basically added this sort of sensor of total external range by adding the so-called centroidal momentum, which is a quantity used in human robotics. And then we also wanted to decouple the estimation process from the estimation of the joint torques and the estimation of external branches. So we use the so-called stack of task approach, which is really common in control. So we basically used a stack of task approach into the maximum posteriori framework in order to get a better estimation of the external forces. And this worked nicely, I have to say. That's Claudia picking up an object from the track, and you can see that the online estimation of the forces are now are pretty stable, okay, and clearly the entire infrastructure works with multiple humans. Okay, so this is basically the overall framework for human estimation. We also worked a little bit with the JSI and Serena and Ottobock in order to estimate the amount of joint torques, which was reduced by the use of an exoskeleton. So the overall approach is quite flexible, and we can integrate systems, external systems like exoskeletons. And basically, this is the overview concerning the human. Now, let's look at the control side really quickly, since I'm running out of time. Okay, so what are the research questions that we try to address in this context? So the first one is, how can a human help the robot? So that's the other way around. We started from the other way around because it was more treatable, and we understood a lot of things here. And the second one is, how a robot can help a human. So in these two questions, so in the first question, we basically focus into the intentional interaction control. And what was the, what is the framework? The framework is that we have the human model, which is treated as a floating-based systems, and also the robot model, which is once again treated as floating-based system. Then you have contacts. You have the contacts, which are treated basically as at least those the feet as holonomic constraints. But anyways, the constraints link these two equations. And they can be really written compactly. So, and in these equations, there are both the robot joint torques and the human joint torques, the human state and the robot state. And the human state, in terms of kinematics and dynamics, comes from the estimation that you saw before. Okay, so one is tempted, basically, if the robot has a control objective, which is xi equals to the Jacobian times the robot velocity. If the robot has to achieve an objective, one is tempted basically to write one single control law in the QP fashion, which often results into feedback linearization. And basically, if you write this, you achieve robot control in the presence of the human. But if you actually do so, the robot behavior is independent from the human interaction because the feedback linearization going underlying the scene is basically canceling out all the interactions. So there is no really shared control here. So then the next step was, okay, let's try to use instead a passivity-based approach. So in this case, basically by simplifying a lot, what was the main approach? I think that most of you know passivity-based, but just to be sure, so if you have x dot equal to f of x plus u, and then you clearly want to do trajectory tracking, you can take a look at the Lyapunov function like the normal squared velocity. If you differentiate it, you have a component which directly depends on the external forces. And as long as this term is negative and you want to do trajectory tracking, you don't need to compensate for it. So you can basically use the same idea in the overall system by using both the human model and the robot model. But there is a subtle detail, is that in the external force that you saw before, if you basically compensate for it when it bothers, you are doing an algebraic loop because the external force depends on the joint torques of the robot, which is the control input. So basically you have to be careful in treating this problem, and also you can parameterize robot trajectories in order to take advantage more about the human interaction. So long story short, what is the overall result? That's Claudia pulling the robot, and the robot basically perceives the entire human state. That's probably the most complex demo, yes, that we have, although jet turbines also are not easy to deal with. But you basically have these controllers, which is passivity based and uses the entire robot, the entire human information. So if Claudia pushes the robot compensates for by. If Claudia pulls too much, then the robot modifies online the reference trajectories according to Claudia's joint torques. Okay, so the overall, we have been building an entire control software infrastructure, which is wrapped in Simulink. So this is also really important for fast prototyping. We built all our infrastructure has been wrapped in Simulink. And then we generate C++ code and binaries directly from the C++. For this, we have been actually invited to a keynote in MathWorks this year that I couldn't give because of the COVID, so it's been canceled, the research summit in the US. But just to give you an idea of the flexibility, you can substitute the human with a robot. So in this case, you have the pink robot on the left-hand side and the red and the green robot on the right-hand side, because the infrastructure is really flexible. So you can basically substitute one of the robots, and the entire software infrastructure handles either the robot or the human in a flexible way. So concerning the other point, how can a robot help a human? Here we are focusing on ergonomic control. So concerning the ergonomy, we started from the so-called collaborative lifting task, working with Inayo, and in this we wanted to focus on the problem of lifting a box, and that's why we built a box. So we built a sensorized box, although it's not strictly necessary because of the estimation of external force that you saw before, but we wanted to be sure about removing somehow unknown problems that could arise from the estimation, and that's why we built a box. So this box has been built in order to be interfaced with ICAB, although ICAB is not born for collaborative lifting. We have been trying to interface mechanically. And then we moved forward in the planning of the experiment. And the planning is basically using the NIOSH framework, which basically gives you the details on how to set up basically an experiment. And then online, you had to have the criteria if you want to optimize basically the you want to optimize the human-robot collaboration task. And these criteria that we use are lifting energy consumption of forces at L5S1, and we want to also move forward by introducing the electromagnetic. But for the time being, we focused on the human joint torques, which are basically the easiest to start with. Let's say this. And so in this video, you basically have two robots, not human and one robot. We started from two robots, and the left robot optimizes the box positions in order to minimize the robot joint torques on the right hand side. Experiments with this, this is the day before the lockdown. So that's the experiment that we did just 1 or 2 days before the lockdown. So we moved forward into the collaborative lifting task, but then the COVID came. So, and in this perspective, I want to tell a little bit briefly our activities during the COVID. As I told you before, we are using our own algorithms for estimating the human kinematics and dynamics. So in the background, we are also developing a suit in a project inside Andy that we call iFeel. And the objective is to bring the human perception at another level. So not only kinematics and dynamics, but also physiological quantities, and also bring feedback to the human, like vibrations and temperature. So we want to modify the human temperature because we think that it can be used in augmented reality systems, environments, and even interoperations. If the robot passes in a warm environment, you have to feel warm, and vice versa. So what we built, it's a network of nodes which communicate wireless with a proprietary protocol that we developed. And then the idea came, okay, why don't we derive from iFeel, which is a network of nodes, one node in order to make a smart band. And this smart band could be useful in order to protect some environments, like at work, like at the airport, like in social competitions, sport competitions, and wellness centers, because we wanted to create a smart band with basically four features. The first one is that it had to vibrate when two smart bands got closer than a certain distance. Then they had to be able to trace the ID of this smart band. So once they start vibrating, they also exchange the identifiers and they memorize it. Then it had to have a temperature sensors in order to monitor some health parameters, and also an overall software infrastructure to also retrieve some contacts of a positive to the COVID. So we derived from iFeel, and that's the magic of we liked a lot because we were working on one thing and we were able to take the wheel and turn it by 90 degrees by doing something we believe to be useful for the outbreak. And that's why we built this smart band that we call iFeelio. So, and this iFeelio basically vibrates and lights up if you get too close. What was unexpected is that after a press release, we have been overwhelmed by requests. So we got about 80,000 pre-orders, and now we are trying to understand how to move forward with this project. Okay, so some conclusions. Humans in the loop requires human perception, and what we are working on is to somehow augment the level of perceptions in terms of somehow quantitative and qualitative measurements. And so we believe that kinematics and dynamics only may not be enough. The idea that we have is that theoretically controllers may also take into account physiological quantities of the human by writing equations and treating them in a single framework. And then we would like also to investigate the crowd of agents and how also the COVID-19 will basically impact the interactions between a crowd of agents. I want to thank all the people working with me. It's been also tough in the COVID outbreak period to come up with something which was useful and concrete. So that's basically the guys without whom nothing that I presented could exist. I finished my presentation, and I don't know if you have any questions.
Thank you, Dani. So there are no questions on Slack. I don't see any question. I hope I didn't miss one.
If I can ask a question. So actually, the solution that you propose seem really interesting, right? How far do you think are we from seeing robots collaborating with us in industrial scenarios? Like I've seen people working with humanoids. Which is the limiting factor right now? Is it the cost or the human factors accepting these technologies? What do you think about that?
Concerning humanoid robots, one of my beliefs is that humanoid robots, it's like internet of the 90s. Everybody thought that it was cool and it was about to explode, but nobody really knew what was for. Okay, but then we discovered that the internet was really important for, I don't know, social media, and we wanted to be connected. Okay, so I think that humanoid robotics is in this now local minimum. Okay, everybody thinks that since the environment is like made for the human, so is an anthropomorphic environment, then an anthropomorphic technology is fundamental. But legs are something that are not easy to deal with. Okay, so the main distance between humans and humanoid robots is how they are made of. So humans are the technology, it's completely different. So humanoid robots are brushless motors, a set of brushless motors. Humans are made completely different. Okay, so if you try to walk with a plate, a metal plate inside below the shoe, you start walking as a humanoid robot, and you change only one interface. Okay, so interacting with the environment, okay, in my opinion, probably may need to somehow move a little bit away from the complete humanoid idea into some, I don't know, hybrid, solution, okay, which would allow an impact on the industry. So that's one reason, in my opinion. And so deriving from human drops some specific solutions could help. And I don't know if the idea of having one single platform like a human robot, which is adaptive to do everything that the humans do, will be effective. Because if you think about it, boats didn't become cars.
I have to stop because we are running late, and we have the next speaker that is Jan Peters, and we have his presentation. Just a quick question. What is the stuff I see on your desk?
This one.
Yes, the violet stuff.
This is the jetpack I was telling you before. Okay, that's the jetpack we designed, and this one goes inside behind the rock. Okay, this is a plug and play jetpack that we designed. We had to modify the backbone of ICAB, so it's But anyways, that's basically the jetpack.
Okay, that's very cool. So thank you, Dani.
Thank you all.
I think we can move forward to Jan Peters, if Jan is there.